So hey, we're going to be in Acts 9. Go ahead and grab your copy of God's Word and open up. We're going to continue in our series that we've been in. So excited to have this privilege to be here with you this morning and open God's Word. As you're turning there, let me ask, you know, when you were little, who did you pretend to be? Who did you imitate, right? We all do that when we're little. I used to put on I'd grab the old ratty towel from the closet and tie it around my neck and jump off the couch, just hoping one time I would take off like Superman and fly around the house. And even if I couldn't actually fly, I'd run around the house and pretend I was flying. I'd try to imitate him and a whole bunch of other superheroes. Who did you imitate? Maybe you followed your mom or dad around. Maybe you idolized them and whatever they did, you wanted to be right next to dad while he was working on the car. You want to be right next to mom when she was cooking a meal, and you wanted to learn how to do that. So you got your own little apron and your own own utensils and worked on it with her. One of the other things I used to do when I was a kid, no joke, I would go into the bathroom and get the little bathroom garbage can, and I would put it on my shoulder, if I'm giving you a picture, and I would walk around the house, and I would collect all the garbage, and I would go outside, and I would dump it in the big garbage can. See, those guys that rode in the back of dump trucks when we were kids, you don't really see that anymore because they're all automated. But when I was growing up, there were men that hung off the back of the dump truck. Like, that was the coolest thing in the world. You drove around town and you were hanging on the back of the truck. And when the truck would stop, they'd get out and they'd go get the garbage cans and then they'd come dump. They were like my heroes. No joke, when I was like 3 years old, I would run around the house and empty garbage cans because I wanted to be like them. In fact, there were a couple times I'd stand at the front door with my little garbage can, and when they pulled up, I'd run out there and the guy would let me dump it into the back of the dumpster. We imitate when we're little. We look at other people and we try to be like them. I've wanted to be a New York Yankee since I was 4. Yes, I know. Let it go. Sorry. And so I wanted to be the center fielder, and I would wear my hat and my glove and my batting glove everywhere I went, even out of season, until I wore my batting glove in the bathtub and it, you know, disintegrated on me. We do things to imitate people. Right, we want to be like people. And as we get older, sometimes that becomes, again, maybe a parent, maybe a boss, maybe a coach. But hopefully, right, hopefully as Christ followers, he becomes the primary person we're trying to influence, we're trying to imitate, actually. And so we want to dig deep into Acts 9 this morning and talk a little bit more about this idea, right? We've just finished a narrative on Paul. Saul became Paul and is now a believer. And we read this in chapter 9, verse 31. It says, "So the church throughout all Judea and Galilee and Samaria had peace and was being built up. And walking in the fear of the Lord and in the comfort of the Holy Spirit, it multiplied." So fear of persecution is gone. At least for now, it's gone. It does come back in the history of the church, but it's gone for right now. The persecution has stopped. Paul's now a believer. Christians have a little bit more freedom. They're going to travel around, the apostles especially, and they're going to help build up the church. So we're going to move from a Paul story to a Peter story. It says that they went about strengthening the church, building up the church, and preaching the gospel. And so this morning, as we unpack the rest of chapter 9, we're going to discover what happens when we do imitate Jesus. And so that's the question I want to answer this morning. What does it actually look like to imitate Jesus? Follow along with me in your copy of God's Word, starting in verse 32. It says this, "Now as Peter went here and there among them all, he came down also to the saints who lived at Lydda. There he found a man named Aeneas, bedridden for 8 years, who was paralyzed. And Peter said to him, 'Aeneas, Jesus Christ heals you. Rise and make your bed.' And immediately he rose, and all the residents of Lydda and Sharon saw him, and they turned to the Lord." The first thing that we realize we need to do if we're going to imitate Jesus is this: go to those who need you. This is exactly what Peter was doing, right? He was going here and there. That simply means he was going to the surrounding churches throughout Samaria, throughout Judea, throughout Galilee. He was traveling. He was visiting the churches to what? To build them up. To meet whatever needs he came across. He was coming to Lydda to build up the church, to encourage them, to maybe preach some of the word to them, maybe to help them even reach some lost people. So he was going there to meet their needs. And then when he got there, he stumbled across another need. He came across Aeneas. And he walks up to Aeneas. As far as we know, Aeneas doesn't ask for this. He just comes up, he hears a story about a man who's bedridden for 8 years. He's paralyzed. No mention that Aeneas asked for this or cries out for this. We don't know any of that. All we know is Peter saw him. He saw a need. He went to him and he prayed for him. "Jesus Christ heals you. Rise and make your bed." Let me ask you a question. When you see a need like that, when your day is interrupted by a need, what's your normal reaction? And I ask that not with any judgment, because I know how bad I can be at that. Right? When my day's going along and I've got my plans, even if I'm going somewhere to help somebody, but oh, something else pops up under my radar that's an interruption in my day. I don't know, for me, this was very convicting. I had a good friend in Arizona, his name was Scott, church that I pastored. He was one of my elders. He helped me grow in this. He was the kind of guy that would let his day be interrupted by any opportunity to serve somebody, to love somebody, to talk to somebody about Jesus. He would let his day be interrupted without hesitation. He calls his wife, his daughter, I'm going to be home a little late. He called boss, I'm going to be in a little late. He had meetings with me. Hey, John, I'm going to miss the meeting today unless you want to come with me. He was a guy that never, ever missed an opportunity. What a great example. Jesus and both Peter said for us, right, go to those who need you, whatever opportunity comes our way. If we want to imitate him, it starts there. And here's the thing, when we imitate him, we get to see God work in these kinds of ways. Do you ever sit back and think, well, I never get to see God at work. I never really see, I hear all these great stories of God saving somebody's neighbor or healing a friend or seeing a life changed or a marriage strengthened. I never see those stories. Sometimes maybe we just need to ask ourselves, am I going to those in need? Because when we do see those stories. Maybe not every time, but we will begin to. And what's part of the end result? Look back at the text. And all the residents of Lydda and Sharon saw him, and they turned to the Lord. Sharon just speaks of the larger region around Lydda. So Peter not only came to meet their needs and build them up and then heal a man that he met, but as people saw him, saw Aeneas, it says that they turned to the Lord. All of them, in fact, is what it says. All the residents, right, turned to the Lord. And so the gospel was preached. Another need was met. We need to never forget that, right? We often think that needs, right, we're surrounded by needs. Right now, you're probably thinking of needs that are around you, maybe in your neighborhood, maybe in your family. You know a family that could use a meal. You know a family that could be prayed for, a family that needs help with maybe their bills. Maybe they need work done around the house. There's all kinds of needs, but we can easily forget the greatest need of every human being is to know Jesus. That's the greatest need we all have. For most of us, I hope all of us in here, that need has already been met, but for the world around us, it hasn't been. That's the greatest need. As much as it might be easier to respond to the felt needs, and we should, we must never forget that the gospel is what needs to go forth first and foremost. And I love Peter's response when you think about it. He was going to those in need. He was intentional. He was purposeful. It says, he was going from here to there. Why? To build up the church, to strengthen, to encourage, to do whatever was needed to build it up. So it was intentional and it was purposeful, but it was also responsive. He responded to whatever he came across. Aeneas was unexpected. Aeneas was unplanned. And we're going to see in the rest of the chapter, Peter's day would get interrupted again. He'd have to go walk for 3 hours for another interrupted need. And Peter responded. He saw a need and he responded. For me, that's the most convicting piece. And notice, Peter doesn't call someone else. You find out about a need, I'm going to call Bill to do it. Bill's really good at that. I don't want to do it. In fact, I'm guilty of this. In Arizona, I would, as the pastor of this church, I would often call my friend Scott because he was good at it. Hey, Scott, so-and-so's in the hospital. You want to go visit him? Why don't you get somebody to go with you? And after about 3 or 4 of those phone calls, Scott's like, hey, John, you're the guy going with me. No, you're great at it. I know. And you're coming with me. I'm not going if you don't come with me. By God's grace, I had a friend who made me come with him. And I needed that. I've never been a great shepherd. I've struggled with compassion most of my life. But because of friends like that, I'm learning to go. And I stopped calling other people. I started to learn, like Peter, to just go, to be intentional, purposeful, and responsive. But if you're like me, and maybe this is something you struggle with, I want to give you just 4 simple ways that you can simply, what do you do when you go, right? We're going to those in need, so what do? The first thing is this: encourage. That's the first thing you're going to do, right? Where is Peter going? He's going to the churches. There are many women in this room, brothers and sisters, that you know that need encouragement. They need to be built up. And I want to be clear on something. Encouragement is not, hey, great job. Way to go. You're really good at that. Those are nice things. Please hear me on this. Those are nice things to say. But encouragement walks up to somebody you know. Walks up to somebody, I'm going to use Britt because he's in my eye line and I know him well, but I would walk up to a guy like Britt and say, hey, Britt, great job. Thanks for that. Nice things to say. I would say, hey, Britt, you know, when I see you serve, I see Christ in you. I can see the Spirit moving through you and I can see his gift of compassion working through you. I just love watching you serve. That's encouragement. especially if somebody's down, to point out how you see, to encourage is to give courage. It's to point out in people where you see God at work in them, what God has already done in them. Man, Britt, I've watched you these last 10 years. You kind of used to be a little rough around the edges, not so nice with new people, and now you're the guy at the front door. That part I'm making up. I think Britt's always been that way. But that's what encouragement is, folks. So when you go to those needs, start there. It starts within these walls. It's been a hard couple of years. Finances are tough right now. It's still a tough season for many of us. We need encouragement. Some of us are walking around these halls going, I just never seem to see God at work in me. But others are seeing it. When you see it, go tell people. Encourage them. Build them up. We can do this with our neighbors and our coworkers too. Where you see, there's maybe you're not seeing Christ in them, but you're seeing strengths. You're seeing abilities. You're seeing God-like, Christ-like attributes in them. Because they're made in His image. You can affirm those and encourage those. Second thing is to pray. Maybe this seems a little simple, but we forget these things sometimes, to pray for people. Not to say, hey, I'll pray for you later. Hey, thanks for sharing that. I'll keep that in mind. I'll be praying for you, which is, again, a good thing. But when you're actually with somebody and they're sharing a need, they're sharing a burden, to pray with them right then and there. I got to tell you, I was super encouraged last Sunday being my first official Sunday here and walking around between the two services, and I saw this happening a lot. Love that about Harvest. Love that about our family. Keep doing it. And by the way, maybe sometimes you even hear about something going on in somebody's life, not through gossip, but out of concern, and it's somebody you know. You don't always have to wait. Peter didn't wait to pray for Aeneas. He just walked up and said, hey, I'm going to do this. So to actually pray with people and for people right then and there in the moment. Third thing we can do is care. When you go to those in need, there's a need. Do your best to meet it. And you might be thinking, well, I can't meet that need, so I'm just going to hope somebody else does. Maybe you know somebody that does. So grab them, bring them with you. Call that neighbor you see that has a need. I'm going to bring my friend over. He knows how to fix this. He knows how to do this. Whatever it might be, actually to care for the people we go to be the hands and the feet of Jesus while also being His voice. And the last one is this, when we go to those in need, to share the gospel really is what we're talking about. That's their greatest need. So yes, meet the felt needs of the people around you who don't know Jesus. Meet the felt needs of your neighbors and your coworkers, your friends at the gym that don't know Jesus. But make sure you get to that point where you share Jesus with them, because that's their greatest need. So let me ask you this question before we move on. What are the needs you're not aware of? Think on that for a second. What are the needs you're not aware of? I don't know, John. How can I know the things that I'm not aware of? Exactly. We don't know of the needs often around us. Peter didn't know about Aeneas' need until he went. So sometimes maybe we just need to start by going, right? Getting engaged, getting involved. And the more involved you are here, you'll be aware of things. The more we are involved in our neighborhoods and our workplaces and our gyms, we will be aware of the needs. And then we can go to those people and do our best to meet those needs, to encourage them, pray for them, care for them, and share the gospel with them. This is Christ in a nutshell, right? This is what He did. It says, Christ came to seek and save the lost. And when He saw the crowds, He had compassion on them. He went to those who needed Him, and so we too need to go to those who need us, or more importantly, those that need Him, and to be Him to them. Let's go back to the text. Pick up in verse 36. Now there was in Joppa a disciple named Tabitha, which translated means Dorcas. She was full of good works and acts of charity. In those days, she became ill and died, and when they had washed her, they had laid her in an upper room. Since Lydda was near Joppa, the disciples, hearing that Peter was there, sent two men to him, urging him, please come to us without delay. So Peter rose and went with them. And when he arrived, they took him to the upper room, while the widows stood beside him, weeping and showing tunics and other garments that Dorcas had made while she was with them. But Peter put them all outside and knelt down and prayed. And turning to the body, he said, Tabitha, arise. She opened her eyes, and when she saw Peter, she sat up. And he gave her his hand and raised her up. And calling the saints and widows, he presented her alive. And it became known throughout all Joppa, and many believed in the Lord. And he stayed in Joppa for many days with one Simon the tanner. Second thing we need to do if we're going to imitate Jesus is have faith beyond experience. Have faith beyond your experience. Right? Peter's day is interrupted again. This time, it's not just, hey, come over to this house. It's about a three-hour journey. It's 10 to 12 miles they're going to walk. It's a three-hour journey for him. And he's going to go to this moment. where Tabitha has passed away. By the way, Tabitha, what did it say about her, right? It said she was someone who goes, Tabitha was someone who goes to those in need. Just going back to her first point, what did she do? She's full of good works and acts of charity. She saw the widows around her and she went to them and she ministered to them. And so, but she's now passed away. And so Peter's day is interrupted and he's going to go. Verse 37b, right? It says, and when they had washed her, they laid her in an upper room. Let me ask you about this part. Does that seem strange? She passed away. Let's prepare her body for burial. Let's put her upstairs. What? Why? We don't know, right? We don't know much beyond what's told here, but they seem to have some kind of a plan. Because that actually, you didn't say you prepared her, maybe she should have been buried, but she didn't. We don't know if there was a custom that we're not told about, but it seems as though they had a plan because they put her in an upper room instead of getting rid of her for burial, and they sent two people with an element of urgency, right? Please come with us without delay, the text says. So they hustled those 3 hours on the way there. Maybe they hustled back. Maybe it was fast. But please come to us without delay. They seem to have some kind of plan, hope, or expectation. Peter goes into this room, right? He meets the widows. He goes into the room, allowing his day to be interrupted a second time. And there's a need. But this is something Peter's never done before. He's only seen Jesus do it with Lazarus. He's only seen Jesus do it with a few others as well. Remember back in Acts 3, he healed a crippled beggar. He and John were there going into the temple, and they healed a crippled beggar. We're told in Acts chapter 5 that many of the apostles, which would have included Peter most likely, healed the sick and those with unclean spirits. And we just learned of Aeneas. That's what Peter's done. Never a resurrection. I'd be pretty overwhelmed walking into that room. Like, I think they want me to see if I can rise from it. Like, we don't know. Again, I can guess. I can fill in the blank. He doesn't appear to be nervous. He seems to get about the business. He seems to go in there without hesitation. But what I do know this is he does not let his faith to be limited by what he's already experienced. Let me say that again. Peter does not allow his faith to be limited by what he's experienced. He's never actually prayed to raise anybody from the dead. Never done that. Only watched it. But he's going to give it a try. And so he does. Tabitha arise, and she does. And I want to fill in the blanks later because there's no excitement that she's arose, at least initially from her part. There's also she was just with Jesus. Is there disappointment? We don't know. We can guess. But even more importantly, right? Peter does not allow his faith to be limited by his experience. How often do we do that, right? Peter believed God is who he says he is. He knows that Jesus can raise people from the dead. He knows that it's Jesus' spirit that dwells in him. So why not try it? Why not pray for somebody who's passed and see if they can come back to life? He believed that God is who he says he is, so he acted according to what he knew about God, and he expected God to fulfill his promises. Years ago, I met a man named William Fay. We brought him into our church to teach a conference on sharing your faith. He's written a book called Sharing Jesus Without Fear. If you've never read it, I'd encourage you to read it. It's not too thick. It's a skinnier one. But in this time that I spent with him in time reading his book, William Fay would share story after story after story of leading somebody to Christ. Never in an arrogant way, always giving God the glory. He just said, at one point, I realized in my Christian walk, either I believe that God saves people or I don't. And if I believe God saves people, I'm going to start telling them. I'm going to start telling everybody I can. I've never led anybody to Christ before. And yes, we all know that the Lord does it. But the Lord has never used me to do this before. But he says he wants to use me. He says that I'm supposed to do this. So I'm going to go in faith, though I've never experienced this, and trust God to lead people to him through me. And he's got hundreds and hundreds of stories in grocery store checkout lines, on airplanes. I'm the guy, I just flew to Denver and back. I get on a plane, headphones on, movie, play. If you don't know Jesus and you're next to me, hope you meet somebody else. Yes, I need to change that, I confess, in front of you. Not William Fay. He sees that as an opportunity to tell somebody about Jesus. He's gracious and he's kind, but he's very clear in sharing the gospel. He's seen hundreds of people. He didn't let his previous faith limit what God could do through him. I had a student when I was a youth pastor in Lake Zurich years and years ago. He came to know the Lord and he was excited about Jesus. And I remember he came to me one day. He's like, John, I feel like God wants me to give out Bibles to students in the school. And I was like, wow. Like, that's bold. He's like, I'm kind of scared. Like, I don't know. But I feel like I'm supposed to do this. So I'm going to go do it. He's never done this before. He doesn't know what God might do through him. He just feels like God has laid this on his heart. And it was specific people. It was five specific friends of his who didn't know the Lord. He had never done this before. But he had the faith to move beyond his experience, and he handed out those five Bibles and watched as those kids at least received them kindly. And a year later, one of those students came to know Christ and became a leader in our youth group because of that student's courage to have faith beyond his experience. What prevents us having greater faith? Why do we struggle to do what so many have done before? It doesn't take a seminary degree. You don't have to be an apostle or a pastor. Anybody, any one of us can step out beyond our experience in faith and just wait and see what God does. So what prevents us from that? Maybe some of us have bought into the lie that God can't use us. Folks, that's a lie from the pit of hell. God wants to use every one of us. It's not about experience. It's not about training. It's not about biblical knowledge. If we just would step out in faith. Maybe you think, right, I'm too far gone, John. I'm such a sinner. Go read John chapter 4. It's become one of my favorite stories the older I get. The Samaritan woman at the well who'd been married to seven or eight different men, just kind of whichever man will take care of her and provide for her, she'll be married to him. Horrible reputation. Samaritans and Jews do not talk. And what did Jesus do? He stopped and talked to this woman. And he spent time with her. And in the end, she becomes a believer in Christ. And what does she do? She runs home and tells her whole village. And many in her village come to Christ. You think you're too far gone? You think God can't use you? Go read John chapter 4. He's waiting to use you and me as we step out in faith. Maybe what prevents you is you think you don't know enough. I'm too new at this. Again, go to John chapter 4. She'd been a Christian for a day. And she goes home and tells her whole village. And many come to the Lord. Go read the story of the Gerasene demoniac, a man who was filled with, I think, 1,000 demons, cast out by Jesus. The pigs run over the cliff, and now this man wants to come with Jesus, and he says, no, go home and tell everybody. No training, no Bible study, no seminary, no Christianity 101. You've been healed. Demons have been cast out. Go home and tell everybody at the Decapolis what I've done for you. A couple days worth of time with Jesus. It's not about knowing enough. None of us does. None of us knows enough. None of us has all the answers, but we trust and we go in faith. Maybe what prevents us is we don't trust God. My guess is maybe this is one of the bigger ones for us. We don't trust that he's going to protect us or save us or give us the courage in the moment, or if we do get spit on or yelled at or cussed out, that we're going to be okay in that moment. But God has proven himself faithful time and time again. If this is where you struggle, what I would encourage is this. Go home and grab a book and just start writing down every prayer you've ever seen answered. Go home and start writing down in that same journal, not just every prayer you've seen answered, but every time God has used you. Every time you've ever seen God work in your life. My guess is you will fill page after page after page. It might take time to remember them all because unfortunately we forget too easily. But God has been faithful, will be faithful, can do nothing but be faithful in your life. And so trust him and go and have faith beyond your experience. Last one is simply this. I don't believe it's true. I just don't believe this stuff, John. Well, I hope the Lord will stir your heart and open your eyes to the truth that it is. And I would say, before you go, grab myself or a friend that's brought you or another pastoral staff and just say, hey, I don't know if I believe this stuff, but I'd like to know more. Listen to what Mark wrote, chapter 11, verse 22. He says, have faith in God. Truly I say to you, whoever says to this mountain, be taken up and thrown into the sea, and does not doubt in his heart, but believes that what he says will come to pass, it will be done for him. Therefore I tell you, whatever you ask in prayer, believe that you received it, and it will be yours. This is true. Every word in this book is true. Every story is true. And so if men like Peter could pray and see the dead raised and the sick healed, what can God maybe do through us? I stand as one who struggles with some of this. What prevents me from greater faith is I give into the lie sometimes that God doesn't really care about my prayers. I have prayers. I've been a believer now, 53? I think so, yes, thank you. I always forget, I have to ask. I came to know Christ at 14, almost 40 years ago. I have family members I've been praying for 40 years who don't know Jesus. It gets hard. It gets discouraging. And I give up. There are seasons when I just give up because I think, Lord, you're not even listening to me. Are you even listening? Are you even there? There's a lot of reasons why, and Satan is good at getting the lies into our brain, but even for me this week, this was a reminder, God is there. God does promise to answer our prayers. He does want us to walk out in faith, and he will do great things when we do. It may not always be according to my plan, but his plans are always right and best. Amen? And so we step out in faith and we go. Let's not let our faith be prevented, folks. So if we're going to go, what does it look like? Well, first thing is to go, to actually begin to go, right? To go to those in need. It starts there. If we're going to live in faith beyond our experience, we have to step out where we may not know what the next step looks like. We may not know what awaits us, but we go because he tells us to go. He asks us to go. Secondly, when we get there, we already talked about this, I won't reiterate, but just to pray and to serve and to share and to do all of that. But what else does it look like? We need to be willing to get uncomfortable. Because it probably is. You think Peter wasn't uncomfortable going up into that room? I don't know all the details, but I tend to guess that he got everybody out of the room because he didn't know what was going to happen. He didn't know. How many in Scripture are told to go? Pastor Jeff and I think even JT both just talked about this. To go and we don't know what's next. We were in Arizona two years ago now, and our elders voted to close our church. It was the right move. And Amy and I looked at each other and said, what's next? I don't know, but I'm unemployed. Let's see what God has for us, because we know that was the right next step. I think Pastor Jeff always says that. What's the right next step? Don't worry about the next 10. What's the right next step? And it might be uncomfortable. For some of us, not knowing the next 10 is uncomfortable, but either way, when we go out in faith, it's going to be uncomfortable at times, but that's where God works. So trust him. And the last thing that it looks like is this is when you go and when you pray and serve and share and when it gets uncomfortable, but you trust, expect God to show up and keep on going. When we're walking in faith, he's right there every step of the way. He's never left. He's beside you. He's behind you. He's in front of you. His hand rests on your head, whether you sense it or not. Scripture talks about that. And so we go and we trust him and we expect him to show up and we just keep going. We go out in faith beyond our experience. Our last one this morning is this. This is our last step. Do exactly what Jesus did. Do exactly what Jesus did. Go back to me to verse 34. Aeneas. Sorry. I'm just going to read verse 33 again. There he found a man named Aeneas, bedridden for 8 years, who was paralyzed. And listen to this. And Peter said to him, Aeneas, Jesus Christ heals you in this part. Rise and make your bed. And immediately he rose. Does this sound familiar besides the fact that I read it earlier? Listen to this from John chapter 5, right? They're down at the pool of Bethesda. There was an invalid for 38 years lying there. And this is exactly what Jesus says, get up, take your bed, and walk. Almost word for word. Peter was just doing what he had learned and what he had watched. In Mark chapter 2, Peter was there when a paralyzed man was let down through the roof. They couldn't get to him through the crowd, so they ripped a hole in the roof and they let him down. And what did Jesus say to the man lying there? I say to you, rise, pick up your bed, and go home. Peter's just doing exactly what Jesus did, almost word for word. Another story in Luke chapter 13, he's walking, he comes across a disabled woman. This woman has not called out to Jesus. She's not asked for Jesus. She's asked for nothing. But Jesus sees her, and it says this in verse 12 of Luke chapter 13. When Jesus saw her, he called her over and said to her, woman, you are freed from your disability. So much like Peter didn't wait for Aeneas to ask for anything, Peter just saw a need and he went up and prayed. To pray for or with the sick, to offer to pray with them, that's exactly what Jesus did. And so we do those kinds of things. We do exactly what he did. We pray for the sick. We pray for those that have needs. You know, I mentioned my flight to Denver earlier. I have to confess, I had a moment of failure, besides the fact that I had my headphones on. Although it was Pastor Tommy sitting next to me, so I figured he didn't need Jesus, right? Hope he doesn't. Just kidding. Had a great time. But on that flight out, I had my headphones on, and I started to hear a little bit of, I saw some movement, and you could tell, you know, when they're speaking over the loudspeaker, it kind of is loud. And so I popped my one ear off, and I could hear that they were calling for a nurse. Okay, somebody in the plane, something's going on. I started to pray for that person. And then I realized it was literally the row in front of me. It was a young couple with their less than one-year-old. Something was going on. And a couple women came up, were nurses, there's no doctors. Okay, this one woman stayed, and the flight attendant stayed. And there was this little, like, nudge in my spirit. I could see the husband was weeping, the father was weeping. Hey, John, you should pray with this guy. I didn't. In that moment, I didn't. We get opportunities more than we know to go to those in need, to step out in faith, to do exactly what Jesus did. And that's where we see God work. Now, am I beating myself up every day? No. We shouldn't do that either. My guess is some of you are like, yep, did the same thing. I missed this opportunity. We're going to miss him. We're not perfect. We're still flawed in this life, unfortunately, right? We're still going to get it wrong at times. I hope I don't the next time. I really hope and pray I don't. And usually that's kind of how it works. You blow one, you don't miss the next one. But give grace to yourself. As we strive to be like Jesus, as we strive to imitate him, as we strive to do exactly what he did, give grace to yourself and to one another, because we're going to miss some. But hopefully as we go on in this journey, we'll miss less and less and less and less. And for those of you that are wondering, because I know people always do, the baby ended up being just fine. Look at verse, look at verse 40 with me. So Peter's now, right, he's now come down to Lydda, to Joppa from Lydda. Again, life interrupted, going to those in need. He steps out, we already said, in this crazy faith beyond experience, but I want to reread it because he says, he put them all outside, he knelt down and he prayed, and turning to the body, he said this, Tabitha, arise. Back in Mark chapter 5, I read this because back in Mark chapter 5, Jairus, who was one of the religious leaders in the synagogue, his daughter had died. You might remember the story. They called for Jesus, and Jesus came. And it says, taking her by the hand, he said to her, Talitha kumi, which I'm probably butchering because I don't know my languages that well, which means, little girl, I say to you, arise. And in Aramaic, there's one consonant different between Tabitha, arise, and Talitha kumi. One consonant different. He literally says almost the same exact words in the moment, outside of one letter. Does it mean we need to memorize Jesus' speech and that's only what we say? No. When we're saying do exactly what Jesus did, we're talking about exactness. What we mean is this, don't reinvent the wheel. Don't try to update or improve what Jesus did. It's not about word for word exactly or step by step exactly, but we know so much of what he did, so go do it. Pick up the Gospels, read them. We know that Jesus came to seek and save the lost. So what did he do? He went about proclaiming the gospel. So do exactly what Jesus did. Let's be people who proclaim the gospel. We get to, by the way. You're going to learn that about me here. I'm a big get to guy. Like, too often the gospel or Christianity or the church work is seen as a burden or something else I have to do. The pastor keeps saying every Sunday, I've got to go do this. If your faith feels like a burden, check your heart, and I say that with grace and love in my heart because I've been there. But we are saved by grace, and we get to do all of these things. We get to go preach the gospel to those who don't yet know Jesus. And that's what he did, so let's do exactly what he did. Let's start sharing the gospel if we're not. I know some of you are doing a great job, but with our neighbors and our coworkers and our friends at the gym and the coffee shops, let's do exactly what Jesus did, and we're going to see him work just like Peter and the apostles did. Jesus had compassion on those in need, and he cared for them. So we know we should care for people. We should actually care about them. I mentioned earlier, especially when I was younger, I didn't have much compassion. The Lord is slowly growing me in that. I got to tell you, even my last year and a half here at Harvest, what a gift it has been to show up at the Hope Center, even just once a month. I know some of you do it regularly, and God bless you and thank you for it. But even once a month to be there, I had a privilege truly to be there and watch so many of you serve so faithfully, and to meet so many who need a meal in this season. You need to grow in compassion. Show up at our Hope Center. You're going to grow. You'll find yourself starting to pay more attention when you're outside of these walls to maybe a neighbor who might be in need or a coworker who might be in need. But Jesus had compassion, so he cared. That's what he did. So let's go do that exactly. Jesus prayed for God's will to be done. He sat in the garden sweating droplets of blood. Father, would you remove this from me? But not my will, but yours. So in your prayer life, pray for his will to be done, not for all your wants and needs and desires. Well, pray for your needs. He tells us to do that. But pray that his will would ultimately be done. Be willing to go into your prayer life with open hands. Lord, I'd love to go to this school. Lord, I'd love to have this job. Lord, I'd love to marry this person. But Lord, your will, not mine. To pray his will be done. Jesus led a pure and sinless life. That's a hard one. This side of heaven, maybe we can't do that one exactly. But knowing that should stir us to pursue holiness, to pursue overcoming sin, not just resting in it or settling in it, like, well, this is just who I am. I can't get over it. I'm never going to know victory. I'm never going to know freedom. I'm never going to have that in my life. Knowing that he led a pure and sinless life should stir our hearts to chase that ourselves, to do whatever we can to overcome sin and temptation in our lives, to find the accountability we need, to learn the truths of Scripture that we need so we can overcome these things and be more like him. We could keep going, but I'll just do one more. Right? Jesus suffered and gave his life for others. I know, not the feel-good one. But this is what he did, so let's go do this. He's not necessarily calling us to actually die, but to actually go out and sacrifice for the people around us. Not just those in our home, though hopefully we're doing it there, but those in our neighborhood, those in our workplaces, our church family. We do exactly what Jesus did. I love what Jesus said in John chapter 13. He said, "For I've given you an example that you also should do just as I have done to you." Now he says that the context, he just washed their feet. Right? Jesus, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, just did one of the most menial, like dirty tasks you could do in culture at the time and washed their feet. He served them. And so that's what we're looking at for every aspect of our lives, right? He's given us an example. So let's go do exactly what Jesus has done, and we will see God work in amazing ways. You know, I was pastoring in Connecticut for a few years. We had a gal in our small group. She'd been at the doctor, and they said, "You have like a slightly smaller than golf ball size lump in your chest." She's like, I have to go in for a biopsy. And she called me up, and she said, "Listen, how does this whole pastor, elder, anoint oil thing work?" And so I read to her James 5, and if you're sick, call on the elders, and they will come and anoint you with oil and pray for you, and you will be healed. She's like, "Okay, I've never done that. Somebody told me about it. I want to do that," right? She's stepping out in faith beyond her experience. Would you guys do this with me? And she's looking at God's word, right? Jesus, the author of our scriptures, tells us to do this. So I'm going to do what Jesus did. I want to do what I saw Jesus do for people. I want him to do it. I want it to be done for me, right? She's imitating scripture in every possible way, shape, and form. And so we did that night. Some of our elders and our small group got around her. We anointed her with oil and we prayed over her. That alone is enough, by the way. If nothing else ever happened from that story, that alone is enough. She did all of these things, right? We don't always know the outcome. It may not always work the way we hope or plan, but that's enough because she imitated Jesus in every way. The great news of that story is she went in for the biopsy and it was gone. Even the doctor said, it's gone. We don't know. She had this huge grin on her face like, "I know what happened, doc. Let me tell you." But that's what it looks like. And it doesn't all, I wish it ended every time that way, don't we all? It will in eternity. It may not in this life, but we still go in faith and we still do these things. Let me ask you this question as we begin to start to wrap things up. Right? There's an old saying, you are what you imitate. So who or what do you imitate? At this stage of life, I hope we're still not putting towels around our necks and trying to fly around our house. Who or what do you imitate? There's nothing wrong with looking at people with great character traits and trying to learn from them. But let's hope Jesus is the top of the list. That even if we're trying to imitate somebody else, it's that we're trying to imitate the Christ in them, right? Paul even said that, right? 1 Corinthians 11, be imitators of me as I am of Christ. Paul's saying, listen, I'm not perfect. Where you see Christ in me, imitate that. Don't imitate the rest of the junk, right? The same thing we wish as parents. Kids, don't imitate all my junk. As my children have gotten older and I've seen a trait in them and I'm like, that's from me and they learned that from me and I'm so sorry, please forgive me. That's not the part I wanted you to get from me. But who or what are you imitating? I hope Christ is the greatest influence in your life and not social media, which may sound silly, but in this culture it often is. I hope it's not the books that you read or the movies that you watch or the anything but Christ. I really hope it's not that. And if you're like me in certain seasons or certain areas, find someone and learn from them. You need to grow in compassion. I had my friend Scott who helped me. You want to learn that? Hang out with a guy like Britt. Hang out at our Hope Center. The Hope Center volunteers kill it every week. I've learned so much from the Crystal Lake Hope Center staff, and I can't wait to start coming here and learning from you guys to help me grow in compassion as I see Christ working through you. But find somebody who's imitating Christ and learn from them as well. Most of all, right, get in his word. Read the Gospels. Learn his life so we can imitate him. And what happens when we imitate Christ is this. People are encouraged. People are prayed for. People are healed. People are saved. And more and better disciples are made. More and better leaders are made. More and better churches are made. We are all growing. We're all seeing God at work. And so let's be a people collectively, right, that go to those in need, that operate in a faith beyond our experience. It puts no limit on what God wants to do through us. And let's go out and do exactly what Jesus did. Amen? Did you pray with me? Jesus, what a privilege it is to be up here, and what a gift this family is to each and every one of us. It's easy to forget sometimes, but our church family is an amazing gift. To encourage us when we're discouraged, to serve us when we are in tough seasons and tough times, to just come around and pray with us. What a gift we have in one another. Thank you so much for it. Thank you for the reminder of your word that stirs our hearts, and pray that that is the case this morning, that our hearts are stirred, Jesus, to be men and women who imitate you. God, I can't get through this without praying first, so if there's anybody here too that they're struggling even to just believe all of this, God, I pray you would stir their hearts, draw them to yourself, give them eyes to see and a heart to understand your gospel, that no one would walk out of here this morning not knowing Christ, and that for all of us, we would walk in greater courage and greater faith. We would go out of this building and look for the ways that we can go to those in need. We become aware of those around us in need because we'd get involved, because we've gone and we've gotten involved, and then we'd seek our best to meet those needs and proclaim the gospel. Help us to trust you every step of the way. Help us to imitate you as best we can, and we look forward to all that you're going to do as we go out in faith as brothers and sisters in Christ. Jesus, thank you that we get to do this. We get to do this because you saved us and made us your own. Thank you so much for that. In your great name, amen.